Good morning, staff and student of Holy Name of Mary.
And welcome to H&M's annual Black History Month Assembly, virtual edition.
Today and for the rest of the month, we will be looking at history and celebrating Black females who are not normally talked about in media.
It is important to recognize that Black history does not start with the negatives. It starts with strength and perseverance.
Today, we will ask you to reflect on the information you learned in today's assembly. Thank you.
Lift every voice and sing, till earth and heaven ring. Ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise
high as the march on till victory is won.
Victory is won.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Shadi Hussein, and today I'm going to be reciting a poem called Black Lives Matter by myself and Shmita Dishpin. All lives matter, some may say, but truth is, it's never been that way. Devalued from birth, denied basic rights, for others what is guaranteed, why must we always fight? Systematically downtrodden, diminished, degraded, they're so excited. Presumption of innocence, none. We are always indicted. At risk in harm's way, exposed to danger center, but their doorsteps they cross, and outside they venture. Their homes, man's castle, not a guarantee, no promise of safety or sanctuary. No time for daytime strolls in the park, harassed, hounded, hunted, killed, if found after dark. With distrust, doubt, derision, always greeted, unfairness and injustice, routinely meted. Of moral and national duty, a shocking dereliction, if there is no collective mission or an immediate connection. So, time to stand up, words repeatedly to chatter, it's my life, it's your life. Black lives are valued, needed, and unrevocably matter. Thank you.
Ready?
Five.
Five, four, three, two.
Hello.
Mackenzie.
Yo.
Okay. I'm ready.
Good morning and welcome to Diversity Club's Black History Month panel. I am Mackenzie. I'm in grade 12 and I co-lead the club. I am Antiguan, Jamaican, and Italian.
I'm Maya. I'm in grade 12. I'm Jamaican and Chinese.
I'm Fantasia. I'm in grade 10 and I am Jamaican.
Hi, I'm Shadia and I'm in grade 12 and I am Somali.
Hi, I'm Tamara and I'm in grade 12 and I'm Jamaican.
Hi, I'm Maya. I'm also Jamaican and Chinese.
Hi, I'm Talia. I'm in grade 12. I'm Jamaican and Guyanese.
Hi, my name is Will Richards. I'm in grade 12. I'm also the co-leader of Diversity Club and I'm Jamaican.
And today we're going to do a panel discussion answering questions asked by you guys in an open discussion.
The first question is, do you feel colonized or pressured by U.S. Black culture, examples music, fashion, art, trends, history, politics, and roots of systemic racism?
I don't think we feel colonized or pressured by USA Black culture. Black culture is something that's universal. I feel like there's two different types of Black culture. There's like Black culture, which is like what we see in media, for example, like a lot of people listen to hip hop, a lot of people dress like this, use slang. And there's like Black culture, which is like a combination of so many different cultures from Black people. So like, for example, there's like Caribbean culture, African culture, North American culture, North American, like, you know, and stuff like that. So.
Okay, like Zoelle said, like, I've never felt pressured by like the sense of like art and fashion and like that sense of Black culture. I feel it makes me feel more connected to like all the Black people like around us. But the sense of like systemic racism, that I feel like generalized by like, the people, like, we're all just placed in a category of what they think Black people are, but we are, like, all different. We all come from different places.
Second question. As a Black woman, what are some adversities you have faced, and how did you overcome them?
I believe, just as a Black woman in general, when we're outside or we're at school, people tend to look at our hair and they're fascinated. And I understand that, you know, it's different than a lot of hair textures, but they'll like start to ask questions and be like, can I touch it? And like, when you ask to touch someone's hair, it's like, yeah, it's okay. I understand you're just trying to like, you know, gain some knowledge about our hair texture and how it feels, but it's kind of offensive. And I feel like a lot of people don't understand that. So with that, you just have to you know, always be polite and just tell, like, politely decline. Be like, no, I'm not comfortable with you touching my hair, because our hair is seen as our crown, and, you know, we take a lot of care of it. So when you see it's, like, glowing and it's voluptuous, you know, we don't want anyone touching it. And I just understand, like, you know, people want to, you know, they're curious, but, you know, that's something that is ongoing today. And it's, I always have to, like, you know, politely decline people. So, yeah.
Like, I see it especially in, like, social media. When you see, like, Black women wearing wigs, a lot of people ask to see their natural hair. And, like, even when you wear extensions, like, me personally, in middle school, like, it was such a constant thing. Because my middle school was mostly Black and brown. For people to have extensions, it was a normal thing. But it was even, like, people who are asking to see our natural hair, people within our community, which I find, like, is kind of weird. Because, like, I don't know how to explain it, but, like, I guess you get what I mean. Yeah.
I feel like when we were growing up, like, a lot of Black girls, like, especially, like, our age group, like, we struggled with, like, fitting in terms of, like, accepting that we look different than, like, other people.
Like, when I was in middle school, I feel like the girls, especially Black girls, were, like, for lack of a better term, were over-sexualized, especially when it came to wearing certain clothing. And, like, I've seen where a teacher might pick on a Black girl for wearing a certain top or certain pants or shorts. And if a Caucasian girl were to wear the same, you know, clothing, they wouldn't say anything.
Like, being someone who has, like, it's not a physical disability, but it's a disability that I have. When it comes to having a disability in the Black community, I've seen it a lot in elementary school, especially with Black kids, especially boys with, like, ADHD. It's definitely a thing, like, medicine-wise. Like, we don't want you to misbehave in class, so we're just going to fill you up with, sorry to say, but fill you up with drugs. And it's just, like, exhausting to see.
Like, with the education and stuff, my mom is telling me that, like, she's a nurse, and she recently encountered someone at her work, and they were just having a discussion, and they're like, oh my gosh, like, you talk so proper, like, how did you get over here? They assume because my mom was Black, she got over here on a boat, and she wasn't born here. And my mom said, like, that's just ridiculous because of the stereotypes that a Black person has. Because my mom was educated, well-mannered, and knew how to talk, that she wasn't born here, that, like, she's not from here. So it's really hard along, like, with the stereotypes that we have, like, being too loud, ghetto, uneducated, rowdy. And I think aside from that, like, Black women are just also, like, not taken serious to a point where it's, like, we think we're not protected enough, especially in society, because you can see that, especially with, like, our mental health and stuff. I think it's really hard when we try to talk about things like how we're feeling and stuff. It's just looked over. And things like you're being told that you're whitewashed. So because that I talk well and I have proper mannerisms and I have proper etiquette because how I was brought up by my family, I'm not Black enough and I'm white. That's ridiculous. So it's like every time, like, you're trying to do something, you're trying to, like, improve and get better, there's always something, like, it's never enough. And also just to add, like, I dance and I'm in a predominantly white dance studio, and I've had many issues where going to dance competitions, they were predominantly white. And I've had an issue where I was dancing and the rankings were completely rigged just because I was Black. So it's like, how is that fair? Because that female was white, and because I'm Black, she gets the higher ranking than me, but I worked just as hard as she did, but we don't get the same type of support. So, yeah.
I think that's, like, another really big thing that people, like, don't realize is that even though maybe the racism isn't as blatant anymore, like how it was once, people aren't yelling out, calling you the N-word in public, even though it still kind of happens, to be honest, today, but the hidden racism, it's still there, and we recognize that through stuff like that. For example, like what Talia said, like, the system was rigged, and how, like, we notice those things. Like, it doesn't go unnoticed by us.
They always feel like Black people don't ever, like, or Black women don't deserve their place, even though they work just as hard.
I think another really big thing, like, just within the Black community, is colorism. Something, like, you know, I think I've faced personally, And then seeing it through social media, it was so prominent. See people talk so poorly about dark-skinned women. And you just felt, like, so worthless. And I just felt real bad about myself. It took a really long time. And that's still something that I still, like, face. I still get into, like, that negative mindset. I still fall into that trap. Seeing people on, like, social media following a lot of other dark-skinned women, seeing representation was a really big thing that helped me, seeing that, yeah, I am still beautiful just because my skin tone's a bit darker.
Because I know for me and my sister, we definitely used the Chinese side of us as, like, a way to not, like, show our blackness. Because I know it happened to my sister a lot. Like, she used it as a way to, like, disguise herself. Me, personally, I didn't, like, define myself as Chinese and Jamaican until later in middle school, until everyone is into light-skinned people or into mixed girls. Like, maybe I'll get more attention this way. And it definitely affected me, because then once I attached to my Chinese side, I was getting bullied for being Chinese. But if I attach myself to my black side, I'll still get bullied.
Okay. The next question is, share your own history of your ancestors and how it forms your identity today. Okay, I'll start. So I am mixed. My mom's Antiguan and Jamaican, and my dad's Italian, and they're both immigrants. So they both came here before I was born, right? And, like, knowing that they struggled to, like, come here and, like, give a better life, not just for themselves, but for me, like, always, like, I always keep that in my mind, and I always, like, push myself to, like, make them proud and, like, make sure that what they did, like, all the struggles they faced was worth it for, like, an opportunity so that I could have, like, an opportunity for something that they didn't have.
I'll add on to that. I think, yeah, also coming from parents that are immigrants, I think I become more empathetic and more, like, grateful for everything that I have. And knowing, even just going back, like, through the ancestry, going all the way back, you know, very hardworking, resilient people, knowing what they've gone through and the history that they had to suffer through, I think it pushes us a lot, especially to want to achieve success, be successful, make them proud. Is there pressure to conform, or do you feel like you have freedom to be true to yourself just as you are?
I feel like there's pressure to conform, and it's always to conform to white people's standards and, like, make them feel okay or comfortable. Like, as much as, like, black people are in the media or like, you're surrounded by fellow black people, you're never really, like,
accepted.
Yeah, because, like, even, like, doing, like, simple things, like, you see it, like, all the time. Like, we were talking about it earlier, like, with, like, wigs and, like, hair and stuff. Like, when we, like, do certain things, we're seen as ghetto, but, like, and it's because it makes white people uncomfortable. But, like, you don't have to, but, like, society raises you to conform to make other people okay rather than you, like, being comfortable within yourselves.
Like, when they act like us, whatever you want to say, it's uncomfortable. Like, me personally, it's uncomfortable for me, because I'm just like, I feel like I'm being made fun of, mocked.
Can I add on? Like, even back to, like, the hair thing, like, I think we've all, like, went through that phase where we all wanted straight hair, because we thought, like, our hair wasn't, like, the proper way to have it. But now you see, like, white people want curly hair now. Like, they'll get perms to have it. Like, they'll do everything to get curly hair. So it's, like, now, because they're doing it, it's accepted. Like, now it's something that's normalized and everyone wants. But when we had it, and it was something that we only had, well, not only had, but, like, normally majority had, it was, like, weird and, like, unprofessional.
I could say, like, when now I'm more comfortable with my skin, but earlier when I was younger, so I had this like desire to think like what the authentic Black culture was. You know, the music you listened to was kind of like hip hop, R&B, how you dressed, how you talked, having Jordans and all this stuff. Like what I saw in media, I always feel like, oh my, I want to be like that. That just wasn't me, like, at that time. Like, I just was into that. So I'd be called stuff like Oreo or, like, you know, like, Black. I'm, like, Black on the outside but white on the inside and stuff, or we call whitewashed. And so I did, like, it took me a really long time to be comfortable and then realize that I just because I don't fit into what that those stereotypical or like what people perceive as being like authentically Black, I'm still Black. I'm still true to myself. It doesn't make me any less Black. But I think that's like a struggle a lot of us go through.
But when I came here and I saw Diversity Club for the first time and I'm like, okay, I don't need to act like that. There's no reason for me to act like that. So I went out my way to start listening to music that I actually like. So now I listen to like Frank Ocean, Tyler the Creator, people who I feel like I can connect to without falling under a narrative.
To add on to what everyone said, like in middle school too, you know, I always had like big hair. But if you knew me in middle school, I would always like put my hair in buns or like try to flatten my hair out so it would conform. I would listen to like A Boogie and stuff, even though I do like A Boogie, that's all I would listen to. And although there was pressure to conform, I found myself trying so hard not to conform to the Black girl stereotype. So like the stereotype of an angry Black woman. So I would just sit in class, allow people to say the N-word, allow people to touch my hair and stuff like that. But so I realized that sometimes it's okay to be angry. It's okay to fit the stereotype.
I just want to say that the pressure to conform isn't necessarily like even just like other races, but our own race. And I just wanted to add to that because I feel like Black people will look at you and be like, yeah, like you're not that type of Black person I want to be friends with. Or like Zoella said, like, you know, you're an Oreo or, you know, you're white on the inside. So it's like you need to conform to be more like this type of Black person to be accepted. And I feel like there shouldn't be any like specific type of Black person. It should just be, you know, you're yourself, be you, and you shouldn't have to, you know, dress or act a certain way to be accepted in society.
When it comes to when we want to stand up for ourselves, it's like we're being told that like if we speak up for ourselves in a respectful manner, we're being told that we're too loud or that we're too much attitude or that we're being aggressive, when it's just that we're just trying to educate or speak for ourselves and let people know what we, how we want to be treated and what we feel is acceptable. Talking to somebody, you're like, you want to call us names and we're being told that we're acting ratchet or ghetto or, you know, those types of things.
Add on, like, oh, sorry, go.
To add to what Tamara and Fantasia said, like, in, like, elementary school, middle school, I went to, like, a predominantly Black school, right? And I never felt like that. I always felt like I was Black. Like no one ever told me anything like I was Black. But then when I came to high school, like I was questioned of like my Blackness. Like I was always told I wasn't Black and Black. So I was like, I never felt like I was Black enough. But then I also never felt like I was white enough. So I never felt like I like fit into a group. But I was like always like an outlier in like the sense.
Okay, just adding a percentage point. About like, I don't know if people think like it's okay, but saying that, oh, like you're pretty for a Black girl, that's not a compliment. And hearing people say that is frustrating. And adding on to Maya Lynn's point about it getting exhausting, it is so exhausting being Black. Because honestly, even when you try, when everyone's talking about, even when you're trying to fit into the group of being Black, or if you're just trying to be yourself, you're always gonna hear something at the end of the day. And I know who I am as a person. I know that I'm loud. I can get rowdy and I'm like energetic and whatever. But what hurts the most is like when I'm hearing it from like people that I hang out with or like hearing it from like my own friends or saying that like, oh, like you need to like calm down. That's probably like the worst thing to hear because it's like when I'm finally like around people who I think I'm comfortable around, they're telling me that like, oh, like you're doing too much, da 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 da. So it's just really hard to like know like how can you even really like have the freedom to be your true self if you're, there's always going to be someone or people saying something about you? Because it's literally never going to stop all the time. And I think like it really just depends on who you're around. Like not all the time, like there's the pressure to feel like you need to conform or whatever. It really does depend like who you're around and the type of people that you hang around with. But I just honestly think like at the end of the day, it's just exhausting. Like it's hard. It is very hard.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We should be angry. Yeah.
We're like always the butt of the joke. Hot Cheeto girl. You're loud and ghetto.
It gets to a point where like it's not your job to educate them. Like the same way like you yourself found the information, Google's free. Like you can go find it yourself. It's not your job to educate these people.
So it's just really hard when people like also make these trends, because it's like, how do you think that's any better? You think because you're praising a certain group of Black women that's helping the other Black women, like that's not doing anything. And it just goes back to being Black is hard. There's always something. It's never enough.
There's so much separation already. It's like separation and a separation and a separation and a separation. It's already like colorism separation, you know? And within both groups is other separation, and there's more separation. It's like, whoa, whoa. Segregation's over, you know? Integrate.
Yeah.
Discuss the Canadian Black culture / community, history, legacy, and successes.
Who are some inspirational Black women that you look up to and why? The floor is yours, Talia.
Sonya Renee Taylor.
Okay, so what's your name?
I found out about her during the summer while like the whole Black Lives Matter movement was going on, and she's all about like promoting like self-love in order to like radical self-love and having good self-esteem in order to perform like social activism and social justice. And so she's really inspirational. I suggest that everyone follows her on Instagram at Sonya Renee Taylor. She's really helped me during this time like to learn how to be like, a better activist and talk more. She had this one video that really helped me, was that I should stop having like conversations or arguments with people over issues that are not argument worthy. Like I shouldn't be having argument on whether like human rights are something that's like are about human rights. Like, I shouldn't be arguing about that, you know? Like it's just the one set. I shouldn't be arguing with people about like, oh, Black Lives Matter movement is a good movement or not. So yeah, I really like her.
Okay, I picked Misty Copeland, which I don't know, you guys maybe know her. She's an American ballet dancer for the American Ballet Theater, and it's one of the three leading classical ballet companies in the States. And I picked her because she was the first African-American woman to become promoted to the principal dancer within the 75-year history of the American Ballet Theater. And I picked her because, you know, like not many Black female dancers make it that far, and she actually wrote a book about like struggles within like the studio and like different like things with the fame. So I really look up to her, and she shows that it's possible. You can literally do anything, just you gotta keep going and fight for what you believe in. And yeah,
so my big inspiration in my life is my sister. She went to Brock University, and she started Black Girl Magic at her school. Yeah. Yeah, I'm wearing it. This is not her shirt. We just bought it, but yeah. She started this. She's doing her master's right now, and her thesis is on, because she's a dancer, like I mentioned before, she's talking about Black dancers within the dance community. And I know definitely it hit her hard, because she has been through a lot. Definitely even when she was a kid, when she came, because she is an immigrant, she moved from Jamaica to Canada. Definitely it hit her hard. Some people would say, I'm not going to play with you because you're Black. When she's at dance, people don't want to be beside her because she's Black. Her teachers don't think she's going to succeed because she's Black. My sister also went to this school. So, yeah. And, like, I'm really proud of my sister, because she's on the shy side. She's not someone that I think, from my point of view, she is very, like, shy. And like when she started this, it definitely rubbed off on me and my older sister to speak out and not be afraid. My older sister went to Mayfield, so she had problems of her own. at that school. And definitely for me, it definitely helped me through seeing this, helped me through middle school, knowing that I don't need to be a follower, I can be a leader. Love you, Amanda. Yeah.
Love you, Amanda.
So an inspirational Black woman for me is definitely Michelle Obama. And I think that because, you know, more recently I've been seeing, like, who she actually is and what she's actually done, because I always seen her as a person that, you know, just sits in the White House, you know, and didn't really do anything. But, like, when she just released her new book, Becoming, I haven't finished yet, but I was able to read through it a bit. And, you know, she talks about her struggles growing up, going to, like, law school and being in predominantly white law office. And, you know, I feel like that's something that I'm going to encounter when it comes to my career in law and during my future. So I feel like this is definitely a passageway in helping me, you know, to, like, remind me and show me, like, yeah, like, you could do this, and, you know, your skin color, it shouldn't affect that. So right now she's one of my biggest inspirations in the Black community.
So my biggest inspiration is definitely my mother. My mother was born in and moved all around the continent of Africa. So she was in Kenya, Uganda, and she's been through essentially so much, you know, going through the war in Uganda, seeing dead bodies on the street. She then moved to Italy, where she worked on a farm and as a live-in maid when she was only 14 to support her family. Then she moved here in Canada, Toronto, Canada, when she was around 19, had a child, started a family. She is now raising 6 kids on her own, which I find really admirable. She's one of the happiest people I've ever met. I don't want her to hear this because I will never hear the end of this, but I just want to say thank you to her. She's honestly such an amazing lady. Everyone loves her, as they should. But yeah, I'm so thankful that I can call her my mom and that she's not different, especially since everything she's been through. Yeah.
Last question. The importance of allyship, and how can you be an ally? I have a message.
Like, it's time for you, like I said earlier, to listen. Listen, please. I know definitely I spoke about it in religion class. I said this is, especially now is the time to listen. The thing that happened in the summer was silent, and I don't want silence. I want it to be heard. I know that a lot of you want to be allies, but there's, like, a limit. There's times where you can talk about it and times where you can't, you know? And again, it's exhausting. So thank you. Listen.
To the H&M community. I think it's super important that the school encourages conversations. What happened in the summer took a serious, like, was mentally draining for, I believe, all of us, all of your Black students, watching what was going on with Black Lives Matter movement, the police brutality happening in America, all over the world, and in Canada too. It was extremely hard for us to watch, especially during the pandemic. I think it's important that you guys encourage conversations, you guys talk about this instead of, like, hiding or trying to avoid talking about it. Put in your reflections, put in your prayers, post on your Twitter, just really, like, talk about it, spread awareness about it, because it's hard as a Black student at this, there's not many Black students at H&M. It's already hard not having much representation within this school. And then when you guys don't really, you guys, like, avoid talking about that situation, it looks like it's not important, as you guys don't really care, which is very discouraging to see. So that's a really big way to be an ally.
Thank you for coming to our Black History Month panel discussion.
We hope that you learned something from this and can apply it to your daily lives. So, yes, hope you enjoyed.
Bye.
We hope you have learned something today and will reflect these lessons in your life.
As allies to the Black community, your responsibility to educate yourself on social issues and take a stand against injustice.
Over the upcoming weeks, Diversity Club will be hosting a Q&A session to discuss cultural appropriation versus appreciation, significance of protest, social justice issues, and much more. This meeting will be open to all staff and students. You won't want to miss